His Holiness clearly mentions and gives some of the guidelines for us tackling about, I guess that one of the self is very heavy. Our solutions to the world problems. I guess that every one of us has a problem. All kind of different kinds of problems, maybe. And His Holiness has mentioned about the war, which is even after the Second World War, the war is going on endlessly. Although everyone knows for themselves from the deep of their heart that the war caused damage, war caused life, war caused grievous suffering, but it is still carried on. And the mass destruction is still going on. Talking about the technology, His Holiness said that global warming, it's clearly warning us. It's really making our life not safe in this very earth. Again, with the economic problem, His Holiness mentioned that the gap we created between the rich and poor, the gap is getting bigger and bigger, wider and wider. And as a result of that gap, what we are seeing is that the society is not in peace. Similarly, there is a big problem in government, the corruption. So these are the few world problems. And as a Buddhist, we are sharing this same planet Earth. What should we do? And one of the solutions, I think His Holiness clearly gave to us, is that all this worldly problem only can be solved through only the only means. And that means is education. So that's why His Holiness emphasizing education one after another. And then the education from His Holiness point of view is that the education should be something not like the headless chicken web education. At the moment, sometimes what we are seeing that education is really a headless chicken education. We don't know where we are turning to. We don't know where we are going to. So the whole idea of education, I guess that this is our job as a panel here. That how we are going to materialize that very education and then we can introduce to our society and our communities. Talking about education, having said about education, I think that is a crucial point His Holiness raised here. Because if we look at the Buddhism per se, as in the morning session His Holiness mentioned that the Buddhism, what Buddhism all about? To put it very simplified, is that the relationship, is that some kind of a behavior pattern, what we call under the name of a sila, the whole corpus of the Vinaya. All the teachings which will make our mind more one-pointedness. Through the mind being one-pointedness, it is just like a water, still water, which can we can penetrate through, we can see through. And that is all the corpus of the sutta, or the Suttanta Pitaka. And of course, we have a more deeper and a more analytical challenging of our own capacity of thinking, that is Abhidhamma or the wisdom. So these three wisdoms, Sila, Samadhi, Panya, is basically, if I don't have to remind all of us here, is that is another way of saying this Sila, Samadhi, Panya. It is actually what in Pali call a three Sikha. So it's a remnants. It is calling here again that how do we materialize, how do we make this education of Sila, education of, on the word, social relationship or compassionate community, the education of meditation, the medication of kind of a self-realization, education of kind of a more resiliency, reflectiveness, and of course, the education of wisdom. So that is, I think, a big task for us. Although, in a very short span, we couldn't able to come with a concrete solution. I think it is for every one of us to think and see that how these problems of war, global warming, the rich and poor gap, corruptions, and so on, how we can minimize that. If you are saying that we can go through the education, how we are going to develop such kind of education which emphasize, which deliver these messages to the mass. So I think this is the chance for us in this room with a cozy feeling. Don't think that it is only few of us here on the stage. I guess that you are down there is more. I think we value your voices more than ours. We are just moderator here, in a sense. So I guess that we might get more elaborations from Venerable Rinpoche and Venerable Geshe and so on, and then maybe we might come up with some other solutions or some of the ideas here. I think that is one of the reflections I would like to start it with here in this session, is that how we are going to materialize that education, that is the education of Sila, the education of Samadhi, the education of Pragya, into the whole mass.
A review of the dialogue we had this morning in the presence of His Holiness. And that had been very appropriately and accurately you have resumed in a nutshell. So we can go forward the questions with which you have touched and raised. As I mentioned last evening, this initiative of dialogue between the Tibetan Buddhist followers and Thai Buddhist followers is really a historic beginning. I think it will lead us to a more in-depth and elaborate dialogues to be continued and share with each other the traditions and the wisdom which the both countries have treasured until now. I have temptation to raise again the three questions which you have formulated after great consideration, and particularly the first question we have discussed this morning, and also you have inscribed in the backdrop. My late friend and a great Indian philosopher, you might have heard his name, Jiddu Krishnamurti. Of course he was not a Buddhist, neither perhaps he was a believer of any religion, so to speak, but he was apparently worldly person, and regarded by many as a philosopher. He used to say, we must learn to remain with the questions, not in a hurry to find an answer or conclusion. To formulate a question in a right way or appropriate manner is the beginning of education. What is the greatest drawback in present education? There is actually no education, no shiksha. It is only input of information. That human beings are considered as a machine or as a raw material which need to be processed through the so-called curriculum of the school, college or university. So we shall have to learn how to live with the questions and how to formulate the questions and how to analyze the point of questions so that an analytical meditative mind can be developed in everyone. So we look to the first question which says, reaching the same goal from the different paths. It is indeed a very important question. But for that, this question can be applied to various different religious traditions, and also it can be applied to the different traditions of Buddhism, the Theravada, the Paramitayan or Bodhisattvayan, or the other different traditions such as Zen and other contemplative or meditative traditions. When this question implies to in the larger context for all the different religious traditions, then the goal and the paths shall have an entirely different connotation. And when it applies to the various traditions of Buddhist itself, then both of these words, the connotation would be entirely different. In accordance to the Nananda tradition or the Sanskrit tradition of Buddhism, the general view is that there are two different viewpoints among the Buddhists. Some section of Buddhist people do believe in three ultimate vehicles, ultimate yans. And the other majority of Buddhists do not believe the three ultimate goals, but the ultimate goal will be only the Buddhahood. And the Arahanthood and the Pratyek Buddhahood are steps to reach to a Buddha nature. And in that way, there are two different gotras of pursuing Buddhahood. The first is who did not enter into a Sarvajnana, directly enter into Bodhisattvayan, and they do not look for the goal of Arahanthood, and they only look for the final goal of Buddha nature, Buddhahood. And there are other kind of disciples who first achieve the cessation of Klesha Avaran, the natural defilements. And then, after that, work for the the cessation of gaya avara. That means the subtlest stings of the kleshas, which are still remain in the minds of the even the arahants. I have no study of Pali tradition, the Theravadan tradition, so therefore I do not know whether the Theravada accepts the three different final goals or only one final goal, the Buddha nature, and all the sentient beings are having the potential to achieve Buddha nature. Whatever it may be, whether the Theravadin accepts the final three goals or final one goal, but it does not have any different goal from the Sanskrit tradition. The Sanskrit tradition accepts that the goal of all sentient beings is to achieve the cessation of the mental defilements and cessation of the seeds of the mental defilements. And if you have seized these two, then you reach to the final goal. So for that case, then the different path does not arise. All different traditions of Buddhism will accept the path would be the development of threefold education, trishiksha, the Sila, Samadhi and Pragyan. Because the root cause of Klesha Avaran, the mental departments, and the Gya Avaran, the seeds of mental departments, are coming from the ignorance, the avidya. Avidya can be eradicated only by the opposite of avidya, that means the vidya, the wisdom. The ignorance can be eradicated by wisdom. To achieve the wisdom with force of, with combination of accumulation merit, the punya samvar. Punya samvar means the practice of five paramitas. The paramita of dana, sila, tolerance, endurance, meditation, and finally these five paramitas will make the sixth paramita, pragya paramita, able to eradicate the entire, even the streams of the Klesha Avaran. So therefore, there may be different culture, there may be different language, there may be different ways of graduation, which comes first and which comes later. Otherwise, the path shall have to be either the middle way approach, middle path, the eightfold Arya Ashtang mark, or the 37 Bodhipaksha dharmas, without which no one can reach to the arahant, no one can reach to the Patil Buddhahood or the Buddhahood. So path would be all the Buddhist traditions shall have to be the same. And I think that we have to keep in mind more particularly that there are different disposition, different outlook, different rituals and different language which are being used. Apart from that, the entire Buddha's teaching, which enshrined into Tripitaka, is common to every Buddhism. I think this we shall have to keep in mind. And apart from that, for the Buddhist people, we have a different what I should say, names which are being given by the Western scholars. The Western scholars have given different expressions and which lead even the Buddhist people into a wrong misunderstanding and wrong way. As mentioned this morning by His Holiness, that many Western people make the expression Tibetan, the Buddhism practiced by the Tibetan people as Lamaism. And Lamaism is a really a mis word which can lead so many misunderstandings. And apart from that, they say Tibetan Buddhism, Chinese Buddhism, Sri Lanka, Thai or Burmese Buddhism, the Buddhism have been given a nationality connotation. This is only with Buddhism, if you look it carefully. Nobody says Pakistani Islam or Indian Islam or Arabian Islam. Islam is Islam. Or nobody says Italian Christianity or Germanic Christianity. No one gives a nationality connotation to a spiritual or religious religion. This only we have. So thereby we say Tibetan Buddhism, Sri Lankan Buddhism. If Buddhism has any nationality connotation, it should have been the Indian Buddhism because it is originated from India. Otherwise, no nation can claim this dharma belongs to them. Of course, at present, the Buddhism has four accepted canonical languages: the Pali, the Sanskrit, the Tibetan, and the Chinese. In these four different languages, the entire corpus of Buddha's teaching are been preserved and available today. So apart from that, we cannot say the Buddhism which is practiced by the Tibetan people as Tibetan Buddhism, by the Thai people, the Thai Buddhism. Then it can be the Himachal Pradesh Buddhism and the Uttar Pradesh Buddhism. It can also divide into many different ways. So this kind of the label which are put by less understanding people of Western scholars, we shall have to be careful about that. And then also this morning there was a lot of discussion what are the basic function of the Buddhist lay people, and to achieve the arahanthood, to become an ordained monk is necessary or not necessary. His Holiness has elaborately deliberated on this, but I am just supplement. To achieve an arahanthood, it is not a precondition to ordained before achieving an arahanthood. A lay person remain in a household can achieve all the four stages and ultimately the arahanthood. But when someone achieve arahanthood, then arahantas are always by the virtue of arahanthood become a bhikkhu. So in the bhikkhu ordination process, we have eight early systems. The Buddha by himself become a bhikkhu, and the arahants and the patik buddhas, they don't need upajayas and bhikkhu sangha to make an ordination sangha karma. By arahant would itself gives the bhikkhuhood as well. Lazy person, as this one has mentioned, are involved into many worldly responsibilities which hindrances for practice of path in a, as a full-time basis. Apart from that, lay people can do a lot. In this matter, I wanted to share with you an information. Among the Sanskrit sutras, there is a very famous sutra, Vimalakirti Nidesh Sutra, which is translated into English two times. I think there's third translation also available. I know two different translations. And Vimalakirti was a leki in a Sharvasti town. And then when he was become sick and he could not attend to a Buddha in the Bihar, Anandapindak Bihar, then Buddha asked what happened to Vimalakirti. He did not come here for several times, and somebody says he is ill. Then Buddha said some monk should go to see him. Then Charputa said, I will not go, he is so argumentative, and I cannot stand to his arguments. And likewise, many other senior monks declined to go to him. Then finally, the Bodhisattva Manjushri voluntarily to go to him to see him. So, I mentioned this sutra because this is available in English language. If you see how a lazy Buddhist can be so intelligent and so full of wisdom. So this is just a casual reference which I wanted to make. To develop a right view, because the right view comes in the very beginning of the Eightfold Path. And before that, how we proceed to achieve a right view, which must achieve from the power of rationality, reasoning, and analyzation. So therefore, in the meditation, analytical meditation and concentrated meditation, the part of shamatha and the part of vipassana equally important, and among them the analytical meditation is more important than the concentrated meditation. So if someone has an analytical meditative mind, then that person can achieve the right view quite easily. And one question which draw my attention, to which His Holiness was not very willing to direct the answer, was about the Buddhist people, whether they should engage into politics or involve into a kind of resistance movement against injustice, rule or injustice things. This is very tricky. Important because we face this problem day in and day out, everywhere in the society. But to make a decision as a sincere follower of Buddhism or practitioner of Buddhism, to make a right decision is very difficult. Because I went through this problem myself. The first question was whether a monk should be engaged into social activities and more political activities against an unjust thing. There are many Buddhist countries. I appreciate Thai. The monks do not apparently or actively participate in the politics, particularly in power politics such as election and so on and so forth. And in Sri Lanka, monks are allowed to become member of parliaments or even participate in elections as well, I was told. And Mongolia, the new constitution, they also make the monks eligible to stand and to vote in the election system. So this is a very relevant question for the Buddhist countries, and I personally of the view that monks should not be allowed to participate in an electionary system. Then the question arises, monks are not a citizen, monks does not have equal right. But in Buddhism, we never talk about right. We always talk about responsibility and duties. We should approach from the duties. Of course, monks has more responsibility and duties than the lay people. But monks should not think anything about the right things. Right is a modern concept. And responsibility is a Eastern and ancient concept. We should care more about our responsibilities than our rights. Why I say this? I am of the opinion, I do interpret Buddha's teachings that a person as a member of society should not accept injustice or immoral activities, and we have a responsibility to oppose them. Not opposing an injustice means you become a party to that injustice dwell. And as a religious person, as a follower of Buddha, it is our responsibility, whether we participate in the politics or we do not participate in the politics. Politics is a very different thing, and opposing an injustice is a different thing. Opposing akushal dharma, if someone is killing, we cannot be a silent onlooker. We shall have to say, this is not right thing, you should not kill. Or someone is stealing, it is our duty to tell stealing is not a good thing, you should not do it. So, not agreement with injustice and also to oppose injustice is the basic responsible of every religious follower, and particularly the Buddhist followers who believe in the difference between the kushal dharma and the akushal dharma, the righteous thing and the non-righteous things. If we, there are three different ways to engaging in akushal dharma, the non-righteous things. You do by yourself, or you ask to do through somebody else, or you just appreciate something is going wrong. Appreciation does not mean you should say sadhu sadhu, but appreciation means you just keep quiet. That means you are not against this act. So therefore, I'm of the opinion that we must oppose all kind of injustice and all kind of wrong things. But that not need, that does not make us necessary to participate in a politics. Sometimes it might require, that I don't know, But there is a great danger in doing so. Great danger is that all wrong things become wrong because it is directly or indirectly related to violence. All action, how we can classify it? The action is right and the action is wrong. From the Buddhist viewpoint, to differentiate right and wrong is whether that action is directly or indirectly causing violence to some living creature, or it does not cause violence, or it is a cause of happiness and benefit. So these are the criteria to judge an action, right and wrong. Buddhist way of opposing to wrong things is opposing compassionately if possible, if not possible, non-violently. Complete non-violent, complete non-violence means you, anyone who opposing that should not have slightest anger or hate to the injustice doer, to the wrong doer. If possible, you must have a compassionate mind, metta and karuna to that doer of sin, because that person is causing harm to others, and by that way causing more harm to that person itself. So therefore, it is a subject of compassion. And today, whenever we individually or collectively opposing some wrong action, we become opposition to that person, not to that action. And opposition to that person means we lose compassionate mind or metta to that person. Then our opposition becomes non-virtuous, akushala. Then in that case, it's better to leave. Instead of opposing, better to keep quiet. So I think this subtle question is very important for Buddhist lay people and also Buddhist monks when we are come to a confrontation with injustice and akushal action, how we should react to that. First, we must examine our own mind whether we are really compassionate to that doer, or we have remotest in our mind or the slightest kind of hate and anger, then all our action goes wrong due to that intention or that mindset. I was told by one of my friends two years back, before the Iraq war, he joined a huge demonstration somewhere in America, and he was shouting slogans. And then at a square, they met with the security people, police people, and they just clashed with them. And then majority of the demonstrators are full of anger. Then he realized what I'm doing. And he just come back from that square, seeing that the anger in the mind of the demonstrators. Then he realized that with this anger, we will not be able to stop the proposed Iraq war. And it actually happened. In spite of millions of people come out on the street, but the war could not be stopped because the demonstrators and the opponents of war could not have enough compassionate mind to the war mongers. So in that in that case, the example of Gandhi, Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, or the popularly known as Mahatma Gandhi, during his Indian freedom struggle, he has demonstrated a number of times how he developed a compassionate mind to his opponents, and then he began to the resistance movement, and thereby he was mostly successful. And when he was not successful, he never blamed to anyone. He says, there was some impure somewhere in my mind, that's why I'm not successful. So I think his example is very good for Buddhists as well, although he was a very staunch Hindu. In spite of that, his way of action is exemplary, and it is totally in consonance with the Buddhist concepts. And these two things come to just to my mind during the discussion. And I again appreciate everyone for this very positive, and I am particularly very impressed the most appropriate message sent by His Holiness the Sangharaja of Thailand, and he pointed out how the way of teaching the Buddha is in the form of dialogue, and which we must preserve even today for finding our own ways and for dispelling our doubts. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, my Venerable Rinpoche. You demonstrate clearly the relationship between external action, be it politics or social activities, and internal quality. Both are closely related. We should, if our internal quality is negative, very difficult for external action to be positive or leading to peace. And I'd like to return to the to what the Dalai Lama, His Holiness said this afternoon about education. He mentioned that education is the solution to the world problem. The world which is full of corruption, misery, oppression. For me, education is a big concept. It can be divided into two categories, so to speak. First, education for spiritual development, and education for morality. In fact, these two kinds of education cannot be separate. But this is the rougher categorization. Education for spiritual development for Buddhism is about the cessation of suffering, to achieve arahanthood, or to achieve the Buddhahood. For me, this is different from education for morality. Education for the spiritual development is the purpose for cessation of suffering. It is beyond morality. It is education for the few people, especially the monastics. But education for morality is about being a good people, good citizen. It is education for the mass, who may be non-believers, as His Holiness said. The non-believers, they should have compassion. It is not monastic education, it is secular education for the mass, especially for the non-believers. I would like to speak more about the latter part, than the latter education. The education for morality can be categorized into two ways. Education through institution, schools, universities, quite formal, which we are already familiar with such education. But I think another kind of education is very important too, informal education. It is education through family, through community, education through the workplace, in the farm or in the office. And such education is not formal. It goes beyond institution. And it is education through the way of living, through the way of relationship with the people, between the family, between community, between colleagues. Altogether, it's about the way of life, which is not about it, not about, or it's beyond institute, beyond school. I think that we, as a Buddhist, should give emphasis on such education too. In other words, how to make family function properly. Now in Thailand, family, community do not work properly. Very weak, family is broken, community is weak, and the workplace is full of competition and animosity, which cultivate selfishness, hatred, anger, and delusion. I think that that if we speak about education, it is very important to think about how to improve the family relationship, how to improve the community, how to improve the workplace, either in the city or in the farm or in the countryside. That means it is about improving how people relate to each other in society and in the way of life. I think this is the big question that in Thailand we fail to do that because of many things. I think this question lead to the concept of Vinaya. Venerable Pajutto, the outstanding scholar monk in Thailand, he said that Buddhism is about Dharma and Vinaya. For him, Vinaya is not about the monastic code. It is about the way of life. It is about the social system. Now in Thailand, the Buddhists in Thailand tend to focus on the Dharma. Cultivate the compassion, cultivate inner peace. But what is ignored is develop Vinaya in wider context. That includes how to make a social surrounding beneficial to morality development, moral development, to spiritual development. And Vinaya should not be seen as only monastic code, which is very narrow. It's about the monks, not about the lay people. Vinaya should be interpreted or expanded to cover the way of life of the lay people, so that the way of living of the lay people would contribute to the development of morality. And in some way, it can be the big step toward spiritual development. especially through the teaching of the monks or nuns. I think this is the big gap that has been happened in terms of education in Thailand. There's one person remarked that education for spiritual development in Thailand is very developed. We can produce a lot of arahat, you know, in Thailand. But education for morality is really weak because a lot of corruption, a lot of robberies, a lot of crimes, and also the decline of five precepts in Thailand is very obvious. So there's a big gap between the education for the spiritual development, which is very developed, and education for the morality, which is very, very low. I think this is it may be happened to other countries too. And so this is the big challenge for the Buddhists, at least in Thailand. This is what I would like to share. If there is any comment or response from the Tibetan side, yes, please. You have time until 4:30.
4:30, so another 15 minutes. Yeah. Not even 15 minutes, in the, to 10 minutes.
We 12 have minutes. 10 minutes?
Yes. Is that right? 4:30? Yeah, if it is 4:30, it's now 4:18.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, venerable Sangha members, venerable Shakya, and the Dhamma friends, it is indeed a great pleasure to see this kind of exercise, this kind of meeting, a meeting particularly with the Thai Sangha members and the Tibetan Sangha members, which I think is a very historical event. When I first saw reaching the same goal from different paths, I thought that we are going to have many religious practitioners over here. But actually, when it comes to the tradition of Thai, Theravada, and the Mahayana tradition, I think we don't have different paths to follow. We have the same path. And what is the Buddha's Shasana? Subhapapasya akaranam, punyasya sampadanam, swachittasya prayavadanam, evang buddhanam sasanam. So this is the Buddha's Shasana. And what is Buddha's Shasana? To control one's mind, to avoid unwholesome deeds, and to accumulate and engage with the wholesome deeds, and to make positive transformations and control one's own mind. This is the Buddha's doctrine. So this is what both the Theravada and Mahayana Buddhists are doing. So, and this is being done through the three sikkhas, the sila sikkha, the samadhi sikkha, and the panya sikkha. And this is what is being practiced, as His Holiness has very rightly said this morning, that in terms of Vinaya, we don't have any differences besides very slight differences in terms of identification of some of the particular vows. Besides those things, we don't have any differences. And in terms of samadhi, as you can see here, the depiction of this painting, in the samadhi, the shamatha, how we develop shamatha, there is no difference in terms of how we developed samatha in both traditions. And in terms of developing panya, there's no difference at all, because in anicca, anatta, patita samuttapada, these are the realities which we need to realize, and this is what is being done in both the traditions. Of course, in the Nalanda tradition, you can find more elaborate kind of demonstrations, more elaborations on these anicca, anatta, patita samuttapada, and anattas, because as we can see that in course of the development of Buddha Dharma, there was lots of interaction between Buddhist and non-Buddhist philosophical schools in Tibet, in India. And when the non-Buddhist philosophical schools made counter-arguments against the Buddhist principles in terms of anicca, in terms of anitta, anatta, and in terms of patita samuttapada, the masters of Vikramashila, masters of Nalanda, masters of Takshashila, these great masters have responded extensively and then developed a philosophical system in order to demonstrate the feasibility of these philosophical principles. That is why, in order to support this, again we have an epistemological system and logic system which developed in course of time in a very, to a very sophisticated level. So therefore, I think these two systems, either it is a Theravada or it's a Mahayana, we are following the same path. So it is not a different path at all, and we must understand each other better. And I think it is not too late, but you know, right time for us to come together, as we have done. His Holiness has mentioned this morning that we, our university has 2 years back organized a Vinaya conference in which we invited the Hmong scholars from Sri Lanka, from Myanmar, from Thailand, and also belonging to Theravada tradition. And we invited Hmong scholars from Dharmakutta, from Taiwan, and from Hong Kong. And then we invited scholars, Hmong scholars from Mool Sarvastivadas. And surprisingly, every scholar, monks who participated at that conference, started appreciating each other, started appreciating the other traditions, knowing that the Vinaya, you know, rules, so far as the Vinaya practice is concerned, there is no difference. So then if you go into the realm of meditation, then again we have the same process, we have the same shamatha, we have the same vipassana. And in vipassana, what we do is we do the abhidhamma, you know, principles, we analyze those things and practice those things. So therefore, I think I'm not going to take much time to make it short. I think this is the education system that we have in Buddhism. And since these panelists are to discuss on the education system, the, as His Holiness has suggested, that how we should, there is an urgent need to educate the world citizens. The present education system is very extroverted. It is very materialistic in nature, that people are informed about the development of a external materialism, whereas the inner development is completely ignored. So now we need to internalize our education system more, in the sense that people can become make more holistic development in terms of developing their mental peace. And you, with the leadership of His Holiness the Dalai Lama, lots of many scientific researches are being done these days. Many clinical researches are being done these days, as a result of which you can see like MBSR, mindfulness-based stress reduction, mindfulness-based the deficiency of attentions to address these issues. And then we can also see like social emotional learnings, in which the people learn how to regulate their emotions. And these all have come from the Buddhist traditions. I think these are, and many of the neuroscientists are doing research on how effective and how much impact the mindfulness meditation and meditation on compassion make impact in one's own mental system, neurosystem, and as a result of which the person, you know, brings a very substantial change, positive change in their behavior, and then consequently they have a much better relation with the other people and make the society much more happier in that process. So I think these are some of the things that even non-Buddhist scientists are learning from the Buddhist, how one can make a holistic you know, development in terms of personal, you know, personal development of personality. So I think these are some of the things that we need to, you know, educate the world citizens in terms of making them more spiritual person. It does not matter. It does not mean that the world citizen should be, you know, converted to Buddhist. But it should be the message that Buddhism has about the spirituality, the peace, converting into a peaceful person. That message has to be, you know, disseminated among the world citizens. So with this, I would end my comment here, and I will pass on this microphone to my next scholar man.
Very close. I was going to follow up on what Miro just said. I think the last session is on just solutions to world problems. And we have both material problems and spiritual problems. I come from a scientific background. I'm a scientific practitioner. So we can offer solutions to world materials problems. His Holiness and Venerables come from contemplative background. And I think contemplative practitioners can offer solutions to the spiritual or emotional problems. As His Holiness mentioned, and in various dialogues that His Holiness had with neuroscientists and psychologists that he mentioned, actually we have now seen the relationship between the so-called neuroplasticity, changing the brains, in response to positive and negative attitudes, emotions, and sensory inputs. So there is this causal link. So I was wondering what kind of dialogues that we should have between what I call contemplative practitioners and scientific practitioners, and what form should it take?
I guess that as the time is very limited, I think this is the question not only for the Venerable here, I think for every one of us here, to really ruminate that questions, and then maybe we can share each other in other sessions about how should we go on, how should we carry on. Just within this very few seconds left, I just want to summarize what is going on here at the moment is that actually what His Holiness emphasized are educations, and then from Venerable Tibetan sites and the Venerable Thai side, the double T here, TT, Thailand and Tibet here, we have two different parts here at least, and then in the name of the different parts, I guess that it is not a different religion, it's a different parts, as we have ladies, we have a gentleman, we have a gentlewoman here. We have all different kinds of businessmen and then all these monastics. So these are different parts and trying to reach the goal. And then through our discussions, as the Venerable Rinpoche has said that he gave one answer, said that even the layman can reach arahat or the Buddhahood as a Vimalakirti. So this is one of the goals for the lay there. So you have hope. You don't have to be really a monastic. So in that sort of a sense, with that of sort of atmosphere, I think what we lack here is education. As we are talking about education here, education in a sense that, as Rinpoche has mentioned, that the modern education is more emphasizing input. They are just trying to put whatever they want to put in our head. So it is not being education. So education, as a Venerable Paisan mentioned, that it is two education, a spiritual development as a morality development. But I guess that whatever it is, we don't have a concrete answer. We don't have a definite answers. But I just want to end with the word education itself. The etymology of educate is to bring out. To bring out. So whatever way you give it, whatever you do it, please bring your humanity out so that we can live as a human in this planet Earth. Be human through education. So thank you.
I'll try to be very brief because I know we are running out of time. But first, I want to thank Professor Win Po Che for addressing my question. Yeah, it's very clear now. You know, I have my guideline. Anyway, I think the emphasis that His Holiness the Dalai Lama placed upon the education, you know, to cultivate the inner peace for the future generation, and followed by Ajahn Paisan's suggestions about the difference between formal and informal education. I myself belong to the formal education institutions. Yeah, for more than 20 years, I worked as a full-time lecturer in a secular university, but happened to be called Dhammasatra. I have my own conclusion that Thai university or Thai formal education only teach two things. First, in science, they teach you how to subjugate nature, you know. And secondly, in social science, they teach you how to dominate your fellow human beings. So I gave up teaching. And I think this poses a very big question when we talk about cultivating inner peace, you know, within the future generation by incorporating Buddhist values and Buddhist explanation of the nature of reality, including human being, into the formal curriculum. So at present I don't see any hope or any way to insert this kind of teachings into the kind of curriculum they have. But that leaves us only the informal way of educating our society. But now Thailand is a strange country, you know. Everybody say he's a Buddhist, she's a Buddhist. But you can't, you know, talk about Buddhism with anyone, you know. Because they kind of reject, you know, oh, don't talk about Dharma today. Let's go shopping, you know. we like to do something else, you know. Don't bore us, you know, with this and that. I feel very happy that today, within a very short time, the Thai monks and Tibetan monks seem to reach an agreement that they only have one path, you know, the same path. Not only the same goal, but the same path. But my question is, what about people who are not monks? What about the general populace in Thailand, for example? You know, it seems like in our country, Buddhism, although is an undeclared national religion, has very little impact on the mentality of the populace, you know, of the general population. And this is something that if we have time later on, I think we should talk about how to start or how to make Buddhism, you make an impact, you know, on the people outside monasteries. I'm sure that monks already find their way, you know, to salvation. But for lay people who are not fortunate enough to live this kind of life, you know, we must find some way to bring them back from extremities. And that's all I want to leave, you know, for this session. Thank you very much.
So as most Venerable Rinpoche mentioned, that the question is the most important answer is not the answer. So we have to find out and formulate the question for all of us. And tomorrow, I think that tomorrow evening session, afternoon session, after His Holiness depart from the hotel, we still have much more time to share for those don't hurry to go out for shopping. Okay, thank you very much. Because we have to leave this hall for another event sharply at 5:30. So we have next. Mr. Prime Minister, may I introduce you to all of us? We have a special guest with us here, Mr. Lobsang Sanjay. Please be somewhere near to Rinpoche. He is the Prime Minister of the government in exile. And he said that today is his holiday, so he come here to participate, to learn. And Samdong Rinpoche have already served Tibetan government in exile for 10 years already.